Today, I'll walk you through the process of optimizing the printbed carrier of my TEVO Tarantula using finite element topology optimization, machining it on my new CNC router, and then testing it out. Guten Tag everybody, and welcome to CNC Kitchen. In one of my last videos, I reviewed the TEVO Tarantula with a dual nozzle extruder. Even though I was able to make some really good looking prints with it, I noticed that the laser cut acrylic bed was very wobbly and even rattled itself apart during one of the prints. So today I'll show you how I made myself a new one. This will be quite a packed video since I made a numerical simulation in order to find out the optimal design and then machined out the part on my new CNC router that even has flood cooling. So the stock heatbed carrier of the TEVO Tarantula is kind of okay if you use the normal aluminum printbed. Unfortunately, on my machine it wasn't really flat, so I wanted to use a piece of mirror where the additional weight caused some really bad vibrations, which even made the screws loosen themselves during one overnight print. In order to fix this problem, increase reliability and get better print results, I wanted to beef up the bed. There are replacement carriers available that you can print out or even purchase separately. These would have been an easier option, but I rather wanted to show you how you can approach such a problem in an engineering style way. In order to evaluate later if our new bed is really better than the old one, I did two things. At first, I printed out one of my ringing test specimens at high speed to see if the quality increases. Then I took some high speed footage of the printbed during printing, where you can clearly see that the bed wobbles quite a bit. Then I disassembled the existing bed, weighed all of the parts and scanned the bed and redesigned it in Fusion 360 as our baseline from which we start with the optimization. I also modeled a dummy of the heatbed itself because we will be needing it for proper mass distribution in the simulation. I exported the model as a step file and opened it in ANSYS Design Modeler. You could perform a basic optimization also directly in Fusion 360, but ANSYS has way more capabilities and they also provide a free education license for this tool. In ANSYS, I extracted the mid-surfaces from the bed carrier. This allows us to later use 2D elements in the simulation that are way more efficient in thin sheet analysis than 3D elements. Also, ANSYS Student has a limitation of 32,000 elements and this limits the size of a 3D model drastically. I then went into ANSYS Mechanicals to set up the model for a modal analysis, which means that I will be calculating the resonance frequencies of the model. The bed was connected to the carrier via beam elements that represent the screws and the two parts of the bed carrier were connected via remote displacements that simulate the rollers that run on the V-slot extrusions. The simulation takes only a couple of seconds and then spits out the resonance frequencies, from which especially the second one is severe because this one will be excited during the movements of the bed. This is now our baseline on which we want to improve on. For the optimization run, it is necessary to define a design region, which means the area where the optimization algorithm can distribute the given amount of material. So, I deleted the stiffener in ANSYS Design Modeler and filled all of the holes that are in the old design. The only thing I was adding is a slot in the front and the back that I need for clearance reasons. I went back into the simulation environment and first changed the material of the carrier from acrylic to aluminum. By running the simulation, we can see which increase in resonance frequency we would get if we would use the whole design region due to the fact that aluminum is around 20 times stiffer than acrylic. Since aluminum has a higher density, this solution would be way heavier, what we want to avoid. Next, we need to set up the topology optimization. The goal of the optimization will be that the aluminum bed has the same final weight than the old acrylic one and be as stiff as possible, what is equivalent to increasing the resonance frequencies as much as possible. This is done by constraining the maximum usable volume of our design region to 37% and setting the optimization goal to maximizing the first and second resonance frequency. I also added two symmetry constraints to get a nicer solution. Finally, I also limited the structures to not be thinner than 10 mm. This prevents too finding crazy structures that would make milling way more complicated, but could prevent a more efficient design. By the way, there is a 75% chance that you are not subscribed to the channel. So subscribe if you aren't yet, and if you like this video, also don't forget to leave a thumbs up. When we start the optimization run, the software will iteratively simulate the model, change the material distribution, simulate, and then, according to the results, change the material distribution again. This is done until the material distribution practically doesn't change anymore and an optimum is reached. According to the boundary conditions and the simulation goal you choose, you'll get many different results, and I also ran the optimization a couple of dozen times until the result pleased me. This is exactly the job of the engineer. The software delivers design proposals and you have to choose the suitable one according to different criteria or just the experience you earned over the years. No software, even though often advertised, will give you the perfect result on the first run if it's more complicated than a simple beam and where the solution is anyway trivial. So this is the design proposal I came up with a first resonance frequency over double the one of the stock acrylic design at the same weight, which is quite an advantage. Interestingly, a CR10 has a bed design that isn't that much different. I exported the design as an STL and imported it into Fusion 360 again. In order to use it for the milling process, we need to convert it to a regular geometry. So, I kind of used it as a blueprint and sketched the outline with some splines and added the holes. And there we have it! I'll be using my new CNC router that I got sponsored from GoCNC to mill the new bed carrier out of a 4mm sheet of aluminum. If you want to make one yourself and don't own a CNC router or a water jet cutter, print the design out on paper and use a jigsaw to cut it out and drill the holes by hand. All necessary files are available for download. In Fusion 360's CAM module, I first created bore tool paths for different size holes and then used the 2D pocket command for the slots where the belts connect. The outer shape is then created with a 2D contour and a finishing path. Since I will use the superglue technique to fix the sheet metal to the bed, no tabs are needed. I used conservative 800 mm/s feed rate at 16,000 RPM and a step down of 0.5 mm, just because I'm not so used yet to my new router. I actually planned to use a 3mm 2-flute carbide end mill, but noticed that I did not have the suitable chuck for it, so I went with a 3mm 3-flute high-speed steel end mill. This also gave me the opportunity to finally use my flood cooling system that is available for the next 3D CNC router. This consists out of an additional rigid and watertight pan with a T-slot table and a pump on the other side that transports the cooling fluids to the spindle. For corrosion reasons, a 50-50 mix of glycol, car cooling fluid and water is used that seems to do the job reasonably well. I bolted a piece of coated multiplex board to the table and put masking tape on both the piece of aluminum and the bed. Then I used superglue on one side and accelerator on the other side and bonded them both together. This is a very convenient technique to work on sheet material and, in my experience, way more reliable than using double-sided tape, screws or clamping claws. After the glue was set, I moved to my zero position, turned on the flood cooling system and then started the program. I had a little bit of chatter, but the cooling fluid kept the end mill cool and prevented chip whirling. Unfortunately, at some point some of the chips that formed got into the cooling system and clogged the nozzle, but there was enough fluid remaining to finish the project. The part came off easily and looked quite good. Surface finish was not perfect, but good enough for my purpose. I deburred all of the edges and then installed it back on my printer. Just by pushing it a little, I was already able to feel that it was way stiffer than the old one. Interestingly, my test prints didn't show huge differences, but I think I might have placed it in the pivot point of the vibration, so it wasn't that affected. But taking a look at the high-speed footage shows that the difference is huge and there is barely any of the vibration still visible. Awesome! All of the prints I did so far came out great, and I didn't notice yet that the bed rattles itself apart. Let's recap. We started with the problem that the TEVO's PRINTBED carrier was too wobbly. We created a simulation model of it in ANSYS to analyze the performance of the baseline. Then we defined the space in which the material distribution could be varied and ran a topology optimization in order to find a design with the same weight but better performance. Then we created a new design from the optimization proposal and machined it from 4mm aluminum, put everything back together and confirmed that indeed it made a big difference. So I think we have succeeded. Let me know what you think of this project. Were you already facing a problem where such an optimization could have helped you? I'd love to read your thoughts down in the comments.
Thanks for watching, everybody. If you want to support the making of these videos, then why don't you become a Patreon and take a look at the affiliate links down in the description. Leave a like on the video, definitely subscribe for more, and why don't you take a look at my other videos. Bye, and until next time.